happy Monday. It's your boy Kevin Thornton. You have tuned in to the world famous Wellness Architect Show. Today's Monday, August 19th, 2019. It's a great and hot day in Atlanta. I have a very great show, a special guest. Somebody I've been trying to get on my show for almost 2 years, but we finally got it done. Before I introduce who he is, I wanted to introduce my co-host, Miss Valerie Riche. How you doing, Val?
I have to take this call. Dr. Watts is calling me, and we're trying to help a client, and I've been trying to get her all day. So give me 1 minute, please, and I'll be right with you.
All right, we're going.
Dr. Watts.
So while she's going to take this phone call, we're going to go to my special guest. So he is someone I went to college with. We went to EMU together, true EMU all day, and he's doing some great things down here in Atlanta. So I'm not going to do your bio. I'm going to let you do your own bio. Tell everybody who you are, what you do, and how you get to this point right here, right now.
Wow. It's an honor and blessing to be here right now with, accomplished author, life coach, fellow comrade, the struggle God seen grow through the years I've grown from. My name is Lee Martin. I'm here in Atlanta currently. I work with young people. I teach special ed in Gwinnett County. Also, I'm heavily involved with AAU basketball as a tool for helping our young people, I've been blessed to be able to do a lot of things, kind of maybe jack of all trades, master of none. Writing, like film, co-host of the podcast, back in the day, one of my partners, and just really honor and privilege to just be around a lot of good people. So it's a blessing to be here, I really enjoy just the whole premise of the Wellness Architect and what we're doing and what we're about. Great show, man. I salute you for having the tenacity to stick with it. I know what it's like to do this, stick with it.
It's hard some days, brother, but it's,
a lot of credit.
I appreciate that. I've been doing a lot the past three shows on men, whether like my cousin. I had my cousin on last week, and he, had been pretty much in jail for most of his adult life, but now he's out. And in that short time, he has published a book. He self-published a book.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, and he wants to be a speaker, and he wants to speak to the youth because he wants, because, pretty much society and the media, for sure, glamorizes, going to jail and make it like it's a badge of honor and the street cred and all that kind of stuff. And he wants to let them understand that it's not really
right
what it is. They want it to be dragged away.
And
so that's what they say it was a very powerful show. I had people coming back from all, calling from everywhere saying, we need something like that again. And I had something else about, the millennials and how their struggle of being men.
Mm-hmm.
And so I said, let me reach out to you because you're doing the teacher, you're a teacher doing special ed. You're reaching the community that kind of way. You are a coach on the AAU team, so you are not just a coach, but you also a mentor to these kids.
Mm-hmm.
Some of them, you might be even a father figure to some of these kids that might not even have a father.
Mm-hmm.
And so it's important for us to have these type of conversations because even though my show is the Wellness Architect and my whole purpose is to inspire, educate people to be the best version of themselves, mind, body, and spirit, I have to take some time to have the wellness of our community.
Absolutely.
Wellness of the men, because if we want our community to thrive and do what we need to do, we need our men and our young boys to be well.
Mm-hmm.
And that's in our mind, body, and spirit as well.
Mm-hmm.
So I unapologetically do my best to interview black men who are doing great things that would never be seen on TV, on mainstream TV.
Right.
So I try to use my platform to showcase and change the narrative of how people see us.
Mm-hmm.
Because it's more people like you and me than it is what they see on TV.
Absolutely.
And so that's why I do what I do, And we was talking on the way in that, people say, we have these high expectations of celebrities,
mm-hmm,
and athletes and what we feel they should do for us in our community, but we don't have the same expectations for ourselves. Right. And we use the excuse that they have the money, they have the platform, but you know, we all do our part, whether it's you being a coach, you being a teacher, that's your platform.
Right.
To touch the masses. Me as a life coach, health coach, you know, this show, this is my way to touch the platform. So we all, you know, use our own lanes and use our own platforms. You know, we could really help heal our community.
Absolutely.
So what's your thoughts on that real quick?
First off, people don't care how much you know until you know how much you care. Mm-hmm. You know, so I really think, they gotta know how much you care. And they gotta know how much you care about them.
Right.
I think that we had expectations for athletes and celebrities to do things that we won't do.
Right.
You know, you won't go to your job and kneel.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? With those $10 hour, $15 hour, don't expect someone else to do that same thing.
Right.
Don't expect them. You have to save yourself. You know, and we have to, each of us is a mentor no matter what you're doing. You don't have to have a title or a position because there's always somebody watching you.
Absolutely.
You know, there's always somebody. As a coach, I know that not only can I can't just talk the talk and tell you to do something, I got to walk the walk too.
Right.
You know, as best I can.
Right.
You know, we all human beings. We all going to make mistakes and stumble.
Right.
But I think being a real person, especially when dealing with our boys, especially when dealing with that, you know, it goes a long way.
Absolutely.
It goes a long way. For all the coaches out there and the parents that are really active in your child's lives, I salute you. I really do. Because when we get a kid that comes in and you know that they have that family structure around them, it really, really helps. Mm-hmm. As opposed, and it helps us give attention, a little more attention to some who don't have that same thing.
Right.
So it's really just building, you know.
Right.
Just building and just trying.
You know? Okay.
They lifelong relationships.
I see Val is back. You ready, ma'am?
Yes, I am. Thank you. Mm-hmm. And apologies to you, but Lee Martin, great to see you. So happy
Thank
to
you.
Have you here.
Good to
and
meet
you. And you just said something, walk the walk and talk the talk. Before we get into it, I wanted to say that's great to hear. And I just want to share this with you. I had a client call me today. I was actually in session with one of our upcoming special guests.
And right.
I don't know who that is. But I took the call because the person kept calling my business line, of course. And I talked to the gentleman and he said, I'm calling from such and such a place and I need a life coach. I really need help. This is what's going on with me. And I talked to him. I got some particulars and I asked him, well, how did you get my number? And he said, well, it said that your office was here, blah, blah, blah. Yes, that is my corporate office. But what bothered me so is that he said he's reached out to so many people and they said, well, I'll call them back. I'll call you back. Let me get back to you. I got to run up the road to such and such place. I'll call you back. And they never called him back. So I know this lady. She was actually one of my professors in my undergrad. She has a practice in that location. And I reached out to her and we were kind of playing phone tag because she was in session. I was in session. And she called me back here at home. And it's just being able to be authentic, as Kevin always says, about who you are and what you do. And like what Lee just said, you've got to walk the walk and talk the talk. So thank you so much for excusing me for a moment to be able to help this person, because I was able to go a step further and say, hey, I've got somebody for you. She's in with the session, but she's going to come back to you. And that's one thing that somebody like Lee Martin does as far as coaching and teaching and stuff like that. Walking the walk and talking the talk. So thank you guys and folks who are viewing in for letting me step away for a quick moment. So now that I've said that, the word of the day, and I got this from our upcoming guest.
Okay.
He used this today in our meeting. He said, unity through diversity. Okay. When he said that, it kind of rang a bell, because a lot of times we talk about, well, I can't do this because this person won't let me, or I look different, or I sound different, or I dress different, or I speak differently. So maybe I can't do thus and so. But I want to challenge each and every one of you to understand your uniqueness. And if you are diverse from the other person, you bring something special to the table. You bring you to the table. Les Brown always says, you have brilliance inside of you. And I truly believe that. So let's first look at what the word unity means, okay? Mm-hmm. According to Webster's Dictionary, the word unity is a state of being united or joined as a whole. So now let's look at diversity. Diversity simply means a range of different things. So I started thinking, unity through diversity. Why is it so important? And I looked at an article that was presented to me, and it talked about cultural diversity being important because our country, the workplace, the schools, they're increasingly consisting of various cultures, racial and ethnic groups. As people from diverse cultures contribute languages, they contribute new ways of thinking. They also contribute new ways of being. They contribute different foods. Now, how many of you out there has gone to a Chinese restaurant, a Peruvian restaurant, a Polynesian restaurant, an Italian restaurant, and you said, wow, I really like the food? Now, if we didn't have diversity in this country, do you think you would have ever enjoyed that food? Probably not. And it got me to thinking about what are children saying about diversity? How do our children feel? Because one thing that I learned is that any type of racial prejudice or anything like that, it's not taught. It is taught. It's not innate. So I want to give you guys quick five reasons why diversity is important and let you know that even though we're taught in many ways that diversity isn't a good thing, these are just some simple reasons from the youth, okay? It's called AMP Global Youth, and that's where I got this from. It says the first one is productivity, and I'm not going to read it all to you. And basically what it says is that we're able to be more productive if we have more minds from various cultures and various races and various beliefs. Now, we may not all believe the same thing, and that's okay. But when we share our ideas, we can help more than just one person. We can help a multitude of people. Another thing that they said is that the perspective, you begin to look at things from a different perspective. If you are, let's say, Latino and you're going to an all Caucasian school, oftentimes you may say, well, maybe I can't be as good as the other students because I'm Latino. Well, guess what? Your difference will bring a shining light to them and help them to see different things about your culture, about your food, about the way you dance, about the way you speak, about your hair texture, the pigmentation in your skin. And growing acceptance, it diminishes discrimination. So of course, unity through diversity helps over time trickle away at discrimination. And as we know, we have a lot of discrimination in this country and abroad. And no matter what we do, we'll never overcome it if we don't understand there is unity and power. There is power in unity, but we have to be unified and unify our thoughts. The other one I want to share with you is that we all have a richer life experience. We have a richer life experience because it makes us more cultured. It makes us more malleable. And I always challenge people, if you've not gone abroad, take the opportunity, go abroad, and you'll learn more and more about unity through diversity. And another quick thing that Mr. Lee Martin is probably going to touch on, because he's a coach, because he's an educator, he has to be diverse. He has to be malleable. The school systems are promoting it more. And even when I worked for the government made sure we took courses in cultural diversity so that we could understand the clients that we dealt with so that we could provide better service. So I challenge you, go out, meet somebody new, try a new food, not just because you're hungry, but because you want to do something different for yourself and help broaden your horizons. So thanks.
Thank you, ma'am. So to piggyback off what she said, with you being an educator in Gwinnett County, which is very diverse Absolutely. In nature, how has that broadened how you interact with the kids and deal with the parents, all that kind of stuff?
First, I mean, it's just been great for me. Mm-hmm. Coming from, Metro Detroit area, mm-hmm. Where there's a lot of diversity, but it's a lot of segregation too.
Absolutely.
Everyone kind of in the North, at least where I'm from, kind of has their own lane that they stay in.
Mm-hmm.
So moving to Georgia, it should be 12 years, mm-hmm. September 1st. Being in Gwinnett totally just changed my whole thought of what I thought the South would be like.
Mm-hmm.
You know, where I am, it's just a big mixing bowl. Mm-hmm. You know, so it's everything from, you know, India, Central and South America, mm-hmm. Africa, North, the South is everywhere. So it's been really good. We've all been able to kind of live together and learn together.
Right.
You know, so a lot of notions that I had about different groups, you know, have kind of, I've learned.
Right.
So that helps me a lot when I'm, you know, working with, you know, with my students.
Right.
You know, and they learning more about me and we're sharing, you know, just different. It really is just, it's just a huge eye opener. And mm-hmm. The great thing about, you know, I'm working on the elementary level.
Mm-hmm.
These kids growing up with this. You know,
mm-hmm.
even my son, you know, he'll be 14 in September, mm-hmm. but the only president he's ever known, you know, outside of our current president,
mm-hmm.
was Obama.
Mm-hmm.
You know, we were growing up to think, you know, we were going to have a black president, you know what I mean?
Right.
That's just something I did not think I'd see, and that's just such his norm.
Right.
So just different groups, you know, and it's just all them work with each other, it's such their norm,
mm-hmm.
that it's more we make the adjustment, really,
right.
than them, you know?
Yeah.
So it really just, I love it.
Because I think for me, I think, and you could chime in too, Lotus, that I just think these new, younger adults, young kids, they don't really have as many limitations mm-hmm. of what they believe and see they could do. I think it's us
mm-hmm.
that place the limitations on these kids because they don't see limits.
No.
They don't see the limits. They don't see the stuff that we see based on our experiences, you know. But it's like it's up to us to heal ourselves from our experiences
right.
and let go of all the limits that we're placing on ourselves
and not put all that heavy baggage on them.
Absolutely,
you know what I mean. Kind of keep, you know. So I have to temper what I, you know, say to a lot mm-hmm. of kids because, you know, coming from a different
right.
teaching Detroit public schools.
Mm-hmm.
My mentality was different. City was different. So I was saying things I thought was going to help prepare them for what they would have to encounter.
Right.
And I come here and I realized a lot of those barriers I'm putting in front of myself. And if I put that, you know, mm-hmm. the barrier in front of my son or my students, you know what I mean? That's something right. I didn't even think about.
Yeah.
So just to really just encourage them.
Because you know? it's crazy, especially I do a lot of stuff out in Gwinnett.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't see these young kids and even the young African-American kids mm-hmm. and they all about their education. And, mm-hmm. you know, I've seen, you know, we may have had dual enrollment while we was going to high school.
Right.
But you didn't see too many of us doing dual enrollment. But there, these kids are all pretty much doing like
Absolutely.
Dual enrollment. They in high school, but they also at Georgia State at the same time. And so by the time they graduate from high school, they are pretty much a sophomore mm-hmm. in college. Mm-hmm.
Right.
Yeah, they're taking advanced placement classes.
Yeah.
They're pursuing their careers. They're not letting anything
yes.
hold them back. You know, they
right.
start a business.
Right.
Start another one. I love it. I love that.
So,
I learn from them.
Absolutely. What do you think? Why is it? I want both of y'all to answer this question. Why do you feel it's important, not only for education to be important for us in our community, but also to have people like yourself teaching and being a mentor in the community? Because a lot of times in schools you don't see a lot of men like you. So mm-hmm. why is it, do you think, is important?
I'm not going to say it's necessarily me. I'm glad to be there because I learned from them as much. What I've learned, this is really my second tour of teaching.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I taught early on when we graduated
mm-hmm.
that I left and, you know, pursued film and different avenues, mm-hmm. law. I came back to this now. I think education has changed.
Awesome.
Education has changed. It's no longer I'm the sage on the stage telling you this, that, the other. Now more, we do these things called turning talks. When mm-hmm. we discuss a lesson, then we had a kid now turn talks to your partner. In all honesty, when those kids are discussing things we went over, they actually learn more from each other than they do from us.
Really?
So I think it's more, we're more now facilitators rather than, you know, the old, you know, essentially where teachers just up, you know,
right.
on the board. And you know, and it's times you do that, but it's really more I'm guiding you because what you learn for yourself is so much more powerful than what I tell you.
Right.
You know what I mean? So a lot of times as teachers now, what I find our biggest thing is just to kind of get out of the way.
Mm-hmm.
You get information. I'm going to guide you. I'm going to kind of get out of the way. And I go around the class and kind of listen to the conversation. I'm like, wow, because some of the stuff they come up with is just so creative. You know? Mm-hmm. So you got to redirect kids sometimes.
Right.
But for the most part, for me, just being that facilitator, it's an honor and a privilege to be there.
Wow.
You know, because when I left teaching the first time, I was like, man, I'm done.
Right.
I'm not going to do this again. And I came back, and it's just like, so every day,
right,
I'm loving it because I love that part of it. So I don't know if I answered you.
No, you did. So what's your thoughts? Why do you think it's important for education for our community, but also to, for them to see somebody like him in the classroom?
I think it's critical to especially see African-American people, but especially men, just not African-American men, but also a myriad of different men. And the reason I say that is because years ago, when I was coming along, you're not going to say how long ago that was. When I was coming along, most of the people that I saw, they were women.
Mm-hmm.
And many of them were phenomenal teachers. But it was a little harder for some of the boy children to kind of get in the groove and kind of identify a little more. And I noticed that when we started taking on more male teachers in our school, it was totally different. Now, I went to a Catholic grammar school and a Catholic high school, and we had priests and we had nuns, and it was totally different because there was a different reverence, if you will.
Mm-hmm.
You didn't want to get the paddle. I'm just going to say that. I'm not going to leave that alone.
Right.
But I think it's very important in today's arena that we see men of color in the schools teaching, being positive role models, because the first concept of what most children see is what they see in the home.
Mm-hmm.
And therefore, if for any reason the father is absent, and that is not always the case in all homes, but in some homes that is the case, if the father is absent, oftentimes when that young boy or that young girl comes to school and she sees a positive African-American person who is a male figure, I think they can identify and they see the worth, and they can say, you know what? Especially the boy children,
mm-hmm.
they can say, guess what? If he did it, I can do it too. That's right. I don't have to go out and just work a menial job, or even if they're bombarded by gangs or if they're bombarded by people who are trying to influence them to sell drugs or what have you, they don't have to identify just with that, because that male role model in their school gives them hope.
Mm-hmm.
Another thing that education is so powerful in doing is minimizing fear, false evidence appearing as real, because a lot of times our children won't move forward because they're afraid that they're gonna fail. But if they see a mirror of excellence right in front of their face, it gives them a fighting chance to say, you know what? I can do this. And not only can I do this, I've got somebody like Mr. Martain to help me forge forward and set a new standard for my life. And it'll change the whole trajectory of their life. And then it's a trickle-down effect. It'll change their friend's life, their cousin's life, and so on.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. That's very important.
Yeah.
And I will say, as a black male teacher especially, to hold my young kings to high expectations.
Mm-hmm.
Because there are a lot of people who the most expectation they have of them is you're well-behaved.
Mm-hmm.
Now, you can be more than well-behaved. You're going, you know, you're a genius.
Mm-hmm.
And we're gonna demonstrate that genius.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so not letting them off the hook. Loving them, mm-hmm. but not letting them off the hook.
Absolutely.
You know, caring about them, but understand you're here to excel, you know. Mm-hmm.
And it's funny you said that. I had that conversation with an adult, male adult,
mm-hmm.
And he went through where, you know, the father wasn't present.
Mm-hmm.
And so that deals with self-esteem issues a lot of times for these young boys and young men. And so, and then they live in a sense of fear, like you said, because the father wasn't present. And
right.
then they feel like their worth is not there. And so they fear that, you know, that nobody will ever love them, fear that they could ever be anything but whatever they are right now, because so they live in a whole set of fear. Mm-hmm. And you know, and I came along to this person and he started to manifest things that he probably never thought he was going to manifest. Mm-hmm. But then that just elevated his fear.
Of course.
Because now he could see everything, you know, all things are possible.
That's right.
But now it's like, okay, if now if I could get this, I could get this. But now
I don't have that crush no more.
I don't have that crush no more. And it's like, you know, like you said, you know, it's our responsibility not just to love them, but also have that expectation of them.
And it makes you check yourself.
Right.
At least for me, I'm like, I can't sit and tell them this and this, and I'm not doing
right
all I can do.
Absolutely.
So it's, you know, I think back in the day,
mm-hmm.
there was more on the teachers to be role models, because a lot of them, they were black first.
Mm-hmm.
They would come through, they had to show that pride and mm-hmm. dignity. And it's still there, but I think now it's a little more subtle. It's more I want to show them, okay, you're exactly like me,
mm-hmm.
and even better,
mm-hmm.
and you can do more. You know what I'm saying?
Right.
So don't, it's not no big me, little you. No, it's...
Right.
You know, you stand on my shoulders like I'm standing on shoulders. You know, we're going to do it that way.
Right.
So I'm not going to let you give me an excuse that you gave Miss, you know,
exactly.
Miss Smith. You know?
Exactly.
No, where's your work? No, we're gonna deal with that. You know?
Right.
So, especially on a Monday. Day like today. On Monday,
uh-huh.
you know, if you deal with them all week, had that weekend all, come back, you got to kind of get them back going.
Right.
So,
you know, you said you was using a teacher in Detroit.
Mm-hmm.
And then you start to pursue your passion
right.
of writing and doing play, you know, TV movies and stuff like that,
mm-hmm.
and all that. What made you want to go back to teaching once you got it?
I think that was always in me.
Mm-hmm.
Both my parents are educators. Mom was a professor at Eastern.
Mm-hmm.
Teacher was always probably in my heart working with children, working with young people in some capacity.
Mm-hmm.
You know, my pops was like, you don't be no teacher, you know, just because of the pay. So
mm-hmm.
I looked at other things, you know, that I thought I wanted to do.
Mm-hmm.
I had a good time teaching in Detroit. I absolutely love Detroit City. It's
mm-hmm.
just, it became for me a drain because some of the schools and situations I was in, it was just so much.
Because mm-hmm.
you were more than just being a teacher. You kind of be depending on and getting pulled in a lot of different ways.
Mm-hmm.
And as a young man trying to find a way too, trying mm-hmm. to find my way,
right.
it was like, let me go on and try to pursue some other things. So even when I was in school, you know, we used to always write, just try to rap,
mm-hmm.
albums and stuff like
right.
that, made videos. So I just tried to just really take that and do that full time with a couple partners I had. And, you know, we had a good time with it. Just,
right.
Who knows, may come back at some point.
It's funny because, so when we was in school, this was, he was one of the conscious guys before now is becoming popular. Mm-hmm. You know, he always was like one of the conscious dudes about us and our community way before now, where you get these, you know, that's like the new hot thing. So, you know, which I always respected, you know, and now he used to have a podcast. And I think now that you're evolving as a person,
mm-hmm.
would you do the same podcast or would you do something completely different?
I probably do both.
Okay.
And I say that to say, I think it's important to like show all facets
mm-hmm.
of us. You know what
right.
I mean? So everything is not going to be positive.
Right.
it's just not, but I don't necessarily consider it negative either. I
right.
just, you know, I got a dark sense of humor too.
Right.
I got a co-host that's, you know, he's off the chain.
Right.
You know that. So, but I think kind of having that, you know, having that balance is good.
Right.
You know, because you, for me, if you go too far on one side, too far, you know, mm-hmm. you kind of, you tend to alienate some of the people that you're trying to touch. You know
right.
what I mean? Or just, even just in being yourself. So, yeah, my evolution and growth is a lot of things that, you know, that as most of us, you know, that were important to me
mm-hmm.
aren't as much, you know what I'm saying?
Right.
But I still try to have the kind of patience and understanding with stuff that may not be, you know, may not be there, but I do recognize that everybody got to, you know, everyone has to grow, or some don't. Everybody's got, right. Everybody's got to kick it in their kind of way. Okay? Right. I don't know if I'm really answering that.
No, but. You know, but it's funny because I've watched your growth, you know. Mm-hmm. And it's funny how we as men do things. Like, women acknowledge other women all the time about, I see you, go girl, all this kind of stuff. We, as men, we just like slide back in the cut and we just watch you. Mm-hmm. We don't really say too much until maybe, like, you know, like for me, like, I remember one time, Aido, somebody we were talking about, he says that I wished him a happy birthday, and then he made a comment to me about, keep doing what you're doing. I'm like, I didn't even know you paid any attention, because, you know, we as men don't do that. But, you know, like for me, I've always watched you and I've seen your growth and your journey, you know, and so, you know, it's really good to see black men evolve and, mm-hmm. you know, and grow and be completely different from who they were before, but still had that same consciousness, but then be more evolved at the same time. Mm-hmm. And so, you know, as a coach, why is it important to be that positive role model? Cause I know, like you said, all the kids don't have that perfect family. No. So, you know, how is it that, you know, they look at you as the coach, but also probably as a dad figure as well?
I was blessed to have a phenomenal father. Mm-hmm. I just passed away about 10 months ago. Mm-hmm. But he was always that. In my neighborhood, he was always neighborhood dad. Mm-hmm. He was always there. You know, now, growing up, I couldn't stand it. You know what I'm saying? Right. Everybody else, Dr. Martin loved my pops, me. I'm like, man, you know what I'm saying? I can't do what everybody else does.
Right.
But it just comes, it really just comes natural. Mm-hmm. I love young people. Mm-hmm. I love working with folks. I just enjoy interacting. Mm-hmm. So even my journey to coaching, I didn't set out to become a coach. I was just a parent on the sideline. Mm-hmm. Gradually, oh, Coach Lake, can you help out? Okay, you do so-and-so? Sure. I love basketball. Grew mm-hmm. up playing basketball. And it just kind of happened. Mm-hmm. And it's basketball, but it's not even really about basketball. It's really about those young people.
Right.
You know you're successful as a coach. I can think back to coaches I had, you know, Inkster, Michigan, Detroit, Michigan, 20, 25 years ago. Mm-hmm. I remember them. The games I don't remember. The scores I don't remember, but I remember what I learned from them. I learned their sayings. I learned what they did, you know. When I got married, some, you know, just calling, wishing me luck, just kind of keeping up with them. So mm-hmm. I look forward to these young men, to their journey,
okay.
seeing where they go and being there for them, you know, in life, you know. And some of them have fathers in the home, some of them don't, but just watching their growth and playing a role in it.
So, Lotus, what's your, you know, I want to, you know, bring you in. Why is it so important for guys like him also to be like a mentor, not just a coach, but also a mentor to these young boys that's playing basketball or football, stuff like that? Because I think it's very important, but I want it from a female perspective. Hold on, I can't hear you.
Okay, can you hear me now?
No, I can't, yeah.
Okay, fantastic. I was saying that it's great that you can play that dual role, because sometimes our young men and women, but especially our young boys, when they start excelling in sports and they're doing very well, sometimes they take their eye off of academia. Mm-hmm. And that's where we fail them, when we don't push academia, because guess what? You can get into sports and you can do very well and you can be pulled into being a celebrity, well paid, you mess up your rotator cuff, you hurt yourself beyond being able to play that season or the next season and the next season, and maybe those $1 million go down the drain. Mm-hmm. And then what do you have left? You're still intelligent. And I know some athletes who play in NBA, who play in WNBA and NFL, and what I've learned from them is that they have taken the time to step back and get educated. And when you have a coach such as Mr. Martin that's saying, look, and you said this earlier, and I wrote it down because I thought it was critically important. You tell your students that you're here to excel. Mm-hmm. And that's a very important point, because a lot of times when kids come into our class, they sometimes feel defeated. But I heard you say, I'm going to let you stand on my shoulders because I'm going to help you get there, mm-hmm. because you're mm-hmm. not here just to be here. You're here to excel. And that goes right back to what Les Brown talked about all the time. Our main problem is not that, you know, we don't focus or we don't aim high enough. The problem is that we aim too low when we hit. So what I heard Mr. Martain say was, look, not only are you going to focus, you're going to aim, but you're going to aim high because your destiny is excellence mm-hmm. and you are here to excel. So devoid of having a person that can play that dual role, it would lead them, they wouldn't have the strength and the mental fortitude that they need to move forward, in my opinion. Mm-hmm. But also, it takes an even balance. So my question mm-hmm. for you is, how do you balance that? Because you're wearing more than two hats, but in that moment, how do you balance that? You're a coach, but you're a mentor, you're a teacher, and you're living your life as a living example in front of them. So how do you balance all that?
That's a good question.
Mm. I don't know. I think the number one thing, the number one thing I try to do, no matter what the format is let the person know I care about them. Mm-hmm. So I listen to them. I try to see what they are. Right. I do want to draw a distinction with some coaches. Some coaches they either live it through their players, or their parents live it their dreams through their players, or they're really focused on wins and losses. I'm not. I'm focused on the process. You know, even for the athletes, the biggest weapon you have is between your ears. It's not your body, you know. Mm-hmm. You have to mentally, I didn't really talk about it. I coach AAU basketball. It's really, really tough. Mm-hmm. These kids they're kind of like, if just think of like kids training for the Olympics, except their sport is basketball. So these are, you know, 10, 11, 12-year-olds. They're getting up at 5 in the morning, working out before school. They're studying on the bus. They're highly motivated, you know, mm-hmm. a lot of them, you know. Mm-hmm. So then you get others, and they think it's just about the game. It's not. You can toss a rock in Atlanta, hit 500 talented players, mm-hmm. but they have to really be strong. So you really just try to, a lot of times, you know, you push them pretty hard. So when it comes to talking to them, like, I might call them over even during the game. They may make a mistake, and they come over, they think they're in trouble, head down. I'm like, you know, how you doing? How you feeling? You're good. You reassure them, kick them back in the game, mm-hmm. you know. And it's the same way with teaching. Like I said, I teach them. We call them exceptional children who may have difficulties learning one way or the other. Mm-hmm. But I don't try to go away from that exceptionality, but I don't let it be a crutch. You know, it's like, mm-hmm. hey, we're going to get this. We're going to do this together. Need a little break? Going to take a little break. Come back to it, you know.
You know, when I heard that you were a coach and you coach basketball, you know, you may not know this, but I used to play basketball.
Okay.
I used to play multitude of sports. So when I first heard that, I thought you was trying to challenge me on the court. I thought I was like, you know, I was like, wait a minute.
You ready to go?
But it's so refreshing to hear you say what you're saying. And mm-hmm. and I remember when I was playing ball back in high school, a lot of the teachers, if you didn't make the grade, you couldn't play. Mm-hmm. And they would contact your parents and say, hey, Lotus isn't doing so well and her history or whatever the subject may be, and she's not going to be able to play ball until then. And if you loved it, you settled down, you got focused, and you got a tutor, mm-hmm. you got deeper into your studies, you got that cognitive juices flowing, and you did what you needed to do mm-hmm. to be on a team. And back then, it didn't matter in my era if you were the star player. Mm-hmm. If your grades were off, you didn't succeed. And I hear you said that, you know, you even on the sideline, you, hey, come here, let me talk to you.
Yeah.
What's going on? You really seed into these young folks, and that's awesome. So I got one other question. Mm-hmm. Who seeded into you?
My father, my uncles, my coaches, my friends, I've just always had a village.
So the village, awesome.
I've always had a village. I'm very grateful. I know that's not everybody's, you know, path. But, I mean, I feel so grateful and blessed for that. That's just something I just always want to try to spread. Because people, they just looked out.
It's funny. I saw he pointed at me. It's funny because I remember one year I was doing a show and I sent a subliminal message to him on the show. Only person who knew what I was talking about was him. God directed wherever my statement was intentionally made for him. And he heard the show and he texted me or sent me a message and he was like, I got you. I got it. You know, because, you know, I was feeling something about, you know, you was on this journey. Mm-hmm. And I think you was struggling with what you wanted to do. You know, you felt you wanted to do this, but you was being led to go do something else. Mm-hmm. And I was like, you know, you got to do you and be 100% unapologetic what you do. Mm-hmm. And, you know, I ain't never have to say his name, but he got the message, stuff like that. And so, you know, I just think, you know, for all of us, even me, I think we all, you know, especially people like me and Lee who are very much nurturers and we nurture other people a lot, we still need some people to pour into us. And so, like, for me, and so, like, when I went home for 2 weeks, that was my time to, like, re-energize. Mm-hmm. And, like, mm-hmm. you know, my dad's still around, so he talks to me and we talk and talk and, you know, I was able to talk to my uncles, all that kind of stuff. And so by the time I got back to Atlanta, you know, I'm back at it. You know, and I'm ready.
Recharged, yeah.
I'm recharged because we got work to do. Yeah. You know. And so you see this man, you know, doing great things as a teacher, and he's motivating the kids to be excellent and have the expectation, you know, just because, you know, they may put a limit on what they expect from you. I'm not going to put a limit on you.
No limits.
You know, on you. You know, my expectation of you is going to be higher than what they have for you. Mm-hmm. Because, you know, we going to create kings and queens.
That's right.
And with that, you got to be great at everything that you do. And then take that same energy and then be a coach. And then you creating these superstar athletes, but also, you know, feeding them in their mind and spirit as well. And I think people don't really realize that's the main thing
that's the goal.
That's the main thing.
Superstar, man. Sports gonna come and go.
Right.
And it's fun.
Right.
But keeping it in context. I mean, you know, even my son dreams being in the NBA, as most do that age.
Right.
You know. But even already, you know, I'm like, okay, well, what do we want to do after that?
Right.
What do we want to do, you know? And I'm not even saying, we're gonna, instead, no, what are we going to do after that? Because even everybody's sports career comes to an end.
It comes to an end.
Some of them sooner than mm-hmm. later. But it does. But just you want to be a superstar person.
Yeah. You know? And it's funny because I remember before I moved down here, I lived in Indianapolis. And one of our fellow EMU alumni, he lived there. He was an ex-football player. Mm-hmm. And Big Walt.
Okay. Yeah.
So Big Walt, you know, and I was part of the 100 Black Men at the time, but I also was like a male mentor for this black business sorority. I forget the name of it, but I was like male mentor. And so I had Big Walt to come and speak mm-hmm. because all the boys wanted to be football players.
Right.
But none of them had grades at all. You know, they all had bad grades. So Walt, no, he had no a scholarship to play football at EMU. Mm-hmm. He graduated and he got drafted where he ended up playing for the San Francisco 49ers for a couple years. And he was like, look, I played with Jerry Rice. However, I didn't make Jerry Rice money.
Right.
So he mm-hmm. was like, so I only played 3 years. He said the standard for most football players is 5 years. And everybody's not making superstar money.
Right.
So right. then what's your... He said, what's your fallback? Mm-hmm. He said, lucky for me, I graduated. And so right. and so now I can still live comfortably. He said, you know, all you all are saying y'all want to be, you know, a football player, a basketball player, but what's your plan B?
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
And know that whatever that is probably going to be the greater portion, the longer portion of your life.
Right.
You know, a lot of folks, you know, are crushed when things don't go athletically the way they think they are. Mm-hmm. And, you know, I have several friends I grew up with that, you know, that just took them, they kind of went in a tailspin. Mm-hmm. You know, when this didn't work out, it took 5, 10, some of them never really recovered from that.
Mm-hmm.
Others who just kind of use that fuel, you know, and go, you know, further. Mm-hmm. Like for me, my dream with basketball ended in college.
Mm-hmm.
And for years, I didn't want to touch a basketball. I watched, but I was just done. You know, mm-hmm. like, okay, I can't cut it to this level. I'm done with it. Mm-hmm. And it's like coming back coaching. I was starting coaching like mid-90s in Detroit. Come back, start, it kind of brought back my love mm-hmm. for it. But even then, you know, working with David, working with my son, has really kind of brought that back. Oh, do you mean?
Go ahead.
Okay. Angela asked a question.
Go ahead, go for okay. it. So she says, see.
How do you motivate or help one to recalibrate when they start to lose focus or fall off the path?
Say again.
Says, how do you motivate or help one to recalibrate when they start to lose focus or fall off the path?
Lois, you can go first.
Yeah, that's a good one right there.
I think you have to identify, first of all, what drove them to fall off the path in their opinion. Because you can't fix or help fix something that you don't know anything about.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
And once, and these are steps, and just mind you, this is coming off the cuff. This is not something I'm sitting down, you know, taking from my client. But you have to understand what drove them to fall off.
Mm-hmm.
Oftentimes I ask people about outside entities, meaning entities outside of themselves mm-hmm. that may have been a contributing factor to cause them to deviate from what their goal was.
Mm-hmm.
So when you find out what that was, then you ask them, well, is there a reason why you succumbed to that? And if you had to do it again, what would you do? One of the primary things I don't do is beat my clients up.
Mm-hmm.
Beat them up. And you have to realize that it's their journey and you're a part of it.
Mm-hmm.
And as a friend, as an uncle, as a coach, as a teacher, as a counselor, whatever you are to them in their life, is to help them carry the burden, to help it be a little lighter, but remind them that they are in control. Mm-hmm. So when they fall off and they get uncalibrated, I try to shore them up with identifying what caused the problem,
mm-hmm.
what would they do differently if they could do it? And then we plan a schematic of how we're gonna come out of that rut, and we look down to see what is our end goal? What do we wanna achieve? And then we start putting everything, it's about systems and planning.
Mm-hmm.
Put everything in place to get to where you're trying to go. And everybody's gonna be different.
Mm-hmm.
One thing that may knock me off may not knock Lee off. Mm-hmm. One thing that may not Lee off may not knock you off. So we want to definitely be a listening ear.
Mm-hmm.
We want to be empathetic, but don't feel sorry.
Right.
Be empathetic and walk the journey with them.
I agree.
I agree.
And I will say, too, is whether it's as a coach or as a friend or whatever, I do agree with Lotus that you got to first figure out what caused them
mm-hmm.
to fall off.
Absolutely.
What's the experience that caused them to fall off? And a lot of times it could be an outside entity that may have placed some kind of fear into them to say they may not can't achieve what they're trying to achieve or whatever situation may be. And they have allowed that to, you know, manifest and become their reality. And then it's up to us to not to listen and to hear, but also once we understand what the issue is, to empower them to understand that, you know, there's no limits to what you could do, but the limits you place on yourself, and that, you know, you have to make the choice to be great. And, you know, I think a lot of times, you know, we all have dreams and aspirations that what we want to do, what we want to achieve. And what I had to learn is I can't tell everybody what my goals and aspirations is.
Yeah.
Right.
You know, because everybody's not going to, you know, identify it because it's not their goal. It's not their aspiration.
Mm-hmm.
And they have limits and fears. And, you know, they don't mean well, mean no harm, but they'll place their fears and their limits onto you.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And you know, Kevin, you took me back to when I was in electrical school. I was in the Navy. And I remember I was doing pretty good in school because I've always been pretty well electrically inclined. And I got a word that my mom wasn't doing so well, that she was ill, and you know, they thought it was a illness that would end her life. So of course, it took my focus away. Mm-hmm. I couldn't think, I couldn't do well. So something that happened that I never saw this happen before, but the person that was seeding into me, they were in the military, they called my mother. And they talked to my parents and told them what was going on with me. And my mom talked to me. My mom, I guess, told them have her call home. So when I called home, I talked to my mom and she says, well, what's going on? I understand that you're not doing so well in your classes now. And then I just told her, I said, listen, this is what I found out. You know, I need to know how you are. And then she talked to me and she said, well, look, this is what's going on. I got this procedure done. I'm doing fine. I'm okay. I need you to focus on your grades and get your grades up. Because in that school, if you went below a certain grade point average, they kicked you out. And you went into the fleet undesignated. And I was trying to become an electrician. But once she talked to me and I knew that everything was okay, I began to recalibrate myself. I began to come back to myself. And so I did graduate at one of the tops in my class because I was able to recalibrate, because what hurt me so bad, I mean, I'm sure you guys can identify with it. I think, Lee, you just said you recently lost your dad. Mm-hmm. So when you at death's door, so, you know, you think you're at death's door with your parents or with another loved one, your focus just goes out the window. But then when you're able to find out what's going on and why it happened, and somebody can tell you, hey, it's okay, then you can recalibrate and regain focus and move forward. So that question from Angela, that really hit home, because, you know, I can really attest that's happened to me. Mm-hmm. And sometimes it's hard to get back in stride if you don't have somebody that mm-hmm. can talk to you. And that's why it's so important that you have to have a person, a teacher, a coach, somebody that can help you get recalibrated, because that's critical.
Mm-hmm. And it's something that you said, I'm going to let you answer too, but it's something that you said, Lee, that made a lot of sense to me too, is that, and I think we all have to understand this, that we all being watched, mm-hmm. regardless of your platform, regardless of your status, mm-hmm. Somebody's watching you. So, yes. Therefore, people are watching you, how you move and shake, and it could influence them for the positive or could influence them for the negative. Mm-hmm. But just know that somebody's watching you. You can affect change through that. And, you know, it was funny because I said congratulations to one of the guys from East EMU. They were doing something. Mm-hmm. And I said, congratulations, you know, keep it up doing big things. And he was like, I'm as big as you, but I'm working on it. I'm like, you know. And so you just never know how people view you and is watching you. And so, you know, this is, you know, just like I see you. You know, we live in Atlanta, but we know we all busy. Mm-hmm. But just because we don't have a chance to really chit-chat don't mean that I don't see you. You know what right. I'm saying?
Yes.
And I just think, you know, we have to understand that we are our influencers in our own way. Mm-hmm. And so what's your thought on that question?
You all answered that better. There's nothing I can say, because, I mean, you all hit that on the head.
Yeah.
There's another one down here.
Go for it. All right.
My sister put that in there. How can men?
Good question. All right, so Dia Martin asks, how can men serve as a positive mentor for young women as well? Good question. I'll start first. I think this being present, I think a lot of times too, we know as men, we focus on men, the boys, because we want to help create positive role models as boys, and since we know we've been that route, we focus on that, but we also need to also focus on the young women as well, because, you know, not in all cases, but in some cases, the man is not present, and the first, you know, male figure that a girl usually falls in love with is their father, mm-hmm. and so the father is the example of what they know a man is supposed to be doing act. So if he's not present, they don't know. So right. then, therefore, it's our responsibility as black men to be that positive influence to showcase the girls, you know, first of all, that, you know, they're worthy of love, mm-hmm. And worthy of love how they are, and they don't have to be anything else but who they are, right. and be loved, but also show them by our examples how a man's supposed to be, how a man's supposed to treat women, you know, mm-hmm. because if they see negative influences of or experiences from men of how they are treating women, that's going to be their reality. So they need the men like you and I to step up and showcase what and how men are supposed to be. Because, you know, it's crazy out here, because if they rely on their mom sometimes, and no shade on the mother, but, you know, if they mother have a certain type, like I knew this young guy whose mother loves, you know, thug dudes. So she think those are the real men. So guys like you and I are not real men in her eyes. So then that reality in her mind is going to penetrate into her girls, and they're going to look for those type of guys because that's what her mother said is real men. So it's up to us to try to change that narrative. So what you think?
I answer it two ways. I answer from a school perspective. I'm always trying to lift, especially because they're so young, I try to put smiles on their faces. I try to compliment the young men and the young women on things, specific things they do. I try not to compliment them on themselves. I don't want them to grow depending on obsession for compliments from men. You know what I'm saying? So it's more like Jennifer. I love the way you did so-and-so and such-and-such. So Jennifer understands, you know, she has work. She has talent. She has beauty. Not, oh, Jennifer, you're so pretty, though. Even Jennifer, right. Me, that pretty, though. I don't want to minimize her.
Right.
You understand? So these are, like, things I'm coming to learn. And that comes from, you know, with my nieces, with my, you know, soon-to-be one-year-old granddaughter. You know what I'm saying? Just kind of really opened up, because a lot of things have really changed the way I view women. And ways that I can almost kind of block, you know, just me just coming in traditional standpoint, like we gotta respect our queens, we gotta protect our queens, and I do agree with all that. It's not I don't agree with it, but it's also you could do anything these boys are doing.
Right.
And a lot of times you can do it better.
Right.
Do that. You know what I'm saying? I'm gonna demand that from you too. I'm sorry, no.
We're going to take a quick break, and we're going to come back, and we're going to let you finish your answer, and we're going to get your answer too. All right? We'll be right back. Good job. We are back. So we want to go back and let you finish your answer to the question that she brought to you.
I guess just really just, you know, for me just kind of recalibrating my view on stuff. I just, everybody says it's about the generations under, but I really do think millennials are a little different than we are. And it's real, for me, it's important to just listen. And I came in the door like I got all the answers and this, then all that stuff may have worked decades ago. You know, now, you're dealing with, you know, it's a different age. Some things don't change.
Right.
But some things, you know, some things do. So a lot of what I do involves a whole lot more listening and a whole lot more. I try not to, you know, kind of attach my values of judgment.
Right.
You know, so I'm going to build you up, but I want you to know.
Right.
I want you to be strong, you know.
And before I let Lotus go, what I realized too dealing with millennials, they are more emotionally intelligent than we are, especially our generation, because, you know, our parents was not emotionally intelligent like that. So we didn't deal with our emotions like that. You know, our parents.
Do it because I said so.
The reason why. You know, the fathers, you know, some father, not my father, was not the one to be like, I love you and all that kind of stuff. Most of the guys in our age range, they didn't experience that. But these new millennials, they are emotionally intelligent. And so then therefore, it's for us to adapt and work on becoming more emotionally intelligent to be with them. And so I think that's a part too.
They need a why.
Yeah.
They need a reason. They need a reason why. And I had to adapt to that. I got more results and more people, you know, they'll listen more when you give them
a why
as to because I said so.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? That don't,
exactly.
Don't fly the way it did. I didn't like because I said so, but that's just.
But we just dealt with it.
Yeah, you kept going. So we probably a little tougher.
Yeah.
But that also probably made us more hold stuff in and conceal it more.
I'm gonna talk about that. But I'm gonna let you go first.
One thing I just got from someone, Angie, she sent this along. She said sometimes millennials don't want the answers, but they're curious about our mistakes and strengths to ensure they are on the right or wrong path. And I think sometimes we rush in because we are fixers, a lot of us.
Yes.
And we want to fix whatever they or what we perceive as wrong, because sometimes millennials don't see it as wrong. They just see it as is. It is what it is. And you hear that term quite a bit. And they don't want us to be the fixers. They want to navigate through it and learn what we've used as strengths and weaknesses to navigate through our lives to become who we are today. But back to the question that the guest posed earlier. Lee, can you read that again? I want to make
it clear. So how can men serve as positive mentors for young women as well?
I think a critical point for men in the lives of young girls and women is to praise the woman as a whole. And when you praise the woman as a whole, you don't defame her in any way. You don't defame her in videos. You don't defame her in records. You don't defame her in the way that you talk. You don't use the B word to her or about her or call her some of these slang terms that they utilize today to describe a woman, a chicken head, a tot, or what have you. I think it's really important if men want their daughters to expect something different, you have to treat the woman you're with that helped you gain that daughter. You have to treat her with the utmost respect, meaning that you can't go out and see other women and take your child to the other woman's house. You can't go out and cheat on her, period. You can't have an argument with your partner and call her every name under the sun and expect for your son and your daughter to look at your wife, your companion, significant other, or what have you, and place value on her. You have to place value on her within the home. If you don't place value on the woman child, if you will, in the home, then you're giving carte blanche to everyone else in society to disrespect her, to beat her down. Like you see a lot of times, it's on video, it's on YouTube, how men are beating women down in the street, how police officers are beating black women down in the street. And my question is not why is it happening? My answer is it's happening because we're not starting at the foundation, and that's at the home. If you want your girl child to behave in a dignified way and not expose her body for attention or expose her body because she feels that she needs to expose it for whatever the reason is, then you have to teach her the value and the worth of keeping her body covered so that when she decides to truly share her body with someone, it's a mystery. I remember Gladys Knight sang an old cover song from New Edition. And she said, I remember back in the day where you go to Lookout Mountain and you'd have enough basic, you know, security or discretion about yourself not to tell what was going on when you went there, or you didn't go full-fledged or be intimate with that person in that way because you were focused on, let me save myself. And I think it really starts at home. It starts whether you have a male figure in the home or not, goes right back to the schools, goes back to the churches, goes back to the coaches. Mm-hmm. If you're a male figure, you have to honor women in every way. And I don't just mean women of color, but every woman. But it's got to start with men of color. It's got to start with you. You got to honor your own women first.
I agree. So I'm a firm believer in that. You know, I think for women and men, I think it's a big disconnect right now, and both men and women are both looking for the same thing, which is love and respect. And so that has to start, you know, at home. And like for me, it's hard. You know, sometimes the dating is can be hard because, you know, I have a father, and so my father's present. And you know, you got a lot of these women who may not have a father, and so they don't know what a real man is, or you know, so they get a lot of these guys that didn't have a father, so they're able to control these men, and you know. The one statement I can't stand because it was fed into me is when men say the woman need to let a man be a man. And how I was raised, my father said, a woman don't have to let you do anything. It's up to you to be the man. Mm-hmm. And not ask for permission. Why are you asking permission to be who you're supposed to be in the first place? Mm-hmm. And so that's what I try to emphasize a lot too, because we know we're asking permission all the time to be who we are instead of just being who we are.
And I concur with that, but I think also when people say, oh, you need to just, men will be men, you need to just let him be a man, I think a lot of times women use that term, and men also use that term in society, to dismiss wrongdoings mm-hmm. that men oftentimes do. I think it's oftentimes used more in that context mm-hmm. to say, you know, yeah, that's okay, but boys will be boys, men will be men. That's what men do. Men cheat, that's what they do. And I beg to differ, because there are a lot of men that I know, they don't cheat. Mm-hmm. There are a lot of men that I know of, to my knowledge. Now, I don't know everything about anything, but what I know, what I've seen, what they demonstrate is that their wives, significant others, they love them very much. They cherish them. And you better not say anything about their wife negative. You better not do anything negative toward their wife. Right. Even if they're out. I have a friend that I used to work with, and he came up one night and he was talking to myself and another lady that we worked with. We were really tight. He was like a brother to us. And he was telling us about this young lady that was trying to holler at him, as you know, as he said, while he was out with his wife. And he said, you know, when I saw her, I told her off, don't you ever try to holler at me. I don't like you. I am a married man, and I don't go outside of my relationship with my wife. And I think if we have more men that's doing that and more women that's doing that, I think it will be better. And we don't need an excuse for bad behavior. Mm-hmm. So when people say, let a man be a man, I think what we should be saying is, while men are pursuing how to be their best self, we need to encourage them. We need to support them, not beat them down and look down on them, but say, you know what? He's trying to be the best man possible that he can be. Because there are a lot of men who have grown up with fathers in the home, mm-hmm. who have not grown up with mm-hmm. fathers in the home, and they're feeling their way through this life.
Oh, yeah.
So I say we need to support them.
Mm-hmm.
I really think it starts with all of us. We have to respect ourselves.
Mm-hmm.
You got to respect yourself. And then you also have to understand what you speak, you're going to manifest.
Mm-hmm.
What yes. you believe is going to manifest. Mm-hmm. So if I'm believing that way about women, or women are believing that way about men, mm-hmm. ultimately you're going to get what it is that you put out there. What it right. is you know you feed yourself right. is what you're going to get.
Absolutely. You know, so if a woman say all men cheat, there are mm-hmm. no good men out there, that's what you're going to attract to you because. Yes. Because that's what you believe. Mm-hmm. That's what you put out into the mm-hmm. universe. Yes. So you know, even though you may not seen it, may not see it, or anything like that, but it could come. Mm-hmm. You know, so you can't you never speak from a negative or mm-hmm. a lack. You know, you hear a lot of times they speak out of lack as well. You know, that there's no good men out here. You know, or it's 20 to 1. I'm gonna have a hard time find a good man. You know, you speaking from a lack, you know, all you need is one. So are you saying to the universe that mm-hmm. you're not good enough to attract one good person?
It's the same way with men speaking negative about women.
Absolutely.
You know, I mean, I can just even look at that in my own life. I know when I thought a certain way, it's a certain vibration I attract.
Yeah.
And as I change, you know what I'm saying, yep. myself, it's a different vibe, yeah. You know, I'm sorry. I know.
No, you're right. No, you're right. Off the top. No, you're right. Be right because that's just where I'm at. Where I'm at now, I attract a different type of woman. Mm-hmm. Who I was in college and when we out in the streets in Detroit, mm-hmm. I attracted a completely different type of woman. That woman I had back then would not be in my vision right now. Nothing against those women because I enjoyed them while I was there, but I'm a completely different person and I'm at a different space. Mm-hmm. So you're going to attract different. So and then it's also the thought. So you know, even though you might have some bad experiences, mm-hmm. I tend never to speak bad on women.
Yes.
Because yes. it's not mm-hmm. all women. It was just that experience, and so then therefore I can't say all women are that way, because then if I do, then I'm not going to never attract the one that's going to be best for me, mm-hmm. because I think all women are a certain kind of way.
Yeah, I think, that's think sometimes when we're with certain people, it goes right back to what Lee said. It's about the frequency and energy that you put out. Mm-hmm. Oftentimes we reflect a mirror image of what we speak out of our mouths. Mm-hmm. If you keep saying, "Oh, men ain't nothing. Men ain't no good." Well, guess what? That's what you're gonna attract. Mm-hmm. So you can't blame the man because right. you called it into existence into your life.
Mm-hmm. Exactly.
If you want a better man, you got to speak it. And then this is the thing. And I have to put this out there. Mm-hmm. A lot of women of color, we will say, "Why he with that Japanese girl? Why he with that white girl? Why he with that? He don't like black women." No, it's not that he doesn't like black women. It's that he just found a spiritual being having a human experience that he cares for, that he loves, or what have you. And it's the same thing with a person of color who is in a relationship with a person of color. That person is someone that you found that you have a something in common. You like them, you love them, or what have you. But oftentimes many women are so quick to say, "Well, he ain't no good because he's not dating in his race." I beg to differ.
Right.
Because yeah. just because a person dates outside of their race doesn't make them a bad person. It just makes them a person who understands the idea of diversity. Mm-hmm. And they've mm-hmm. gone beyond the color barrier. And I think a lot of times if we stop having color barriers within our own race, because you gotta admit, a lot of people within our own race, we're not gonna date somebody that's the color of my phone.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Some of us are not gonna date somebody that's super, super light pigmented, mm-hmm. right?
Right.
They're not gonna date. So it again starts with what we think.
That's right.
And the frequency we put out. Mm-hmm. And like you said, Kevin, where you were then, when you were in college, you were a different man.
Right.
And same thing with you, Lee. Mm-hmm. Where I was when I was in college, whole different woman. But today, because of people who've coached us, people who've trained us, we've become better. And that pulls up a question for you, Lee. If you could give yourself any message from today to the man you were just 5 years ago, what would that message be?
Good 5 years ago? Trust yourself. Trust yourself. And step out and be who you are. I think for, you know, I know Kevin's age, I know our generation, I think we may have been the last generation that that path to education was just direct. You go to school, you get this, you do that. And that was really good, but it also, honestly, it blocked me from going after my stuff full speed outside of traditional, you know, outside of a traditional path.
Right.
So I was always torn, you know. I went to law school because... okay, that's what you're supposed to do. And the last is what you're supposed to do, but it brought me no satisfaction walking that path. So me 5 years ago and where I was, I would tell, you know, where I am now, I'm very happy and want to continue going that direction. But I was right at that point of, okay, am I going to, you know, kind of devote the remainder of my life to trying to walk a path, or am I going to try to blaze my own? So really just trust yourself, do what it is you feel like you put here to do. You feel like you're called to do. Like you said earlier, you know, you a soul having a human experience. That's what's really going on. So let's, you know, let's move forward in that direction. You
know? I like that answer, because that would be what I would say to myself. Trust yourself and trust the journey. I think, like you said, you know, growing up, you know, they want you to go to school. You know, a lot of times, you know, we... a lot of us was not experienced around people being entrepreneurs. So, you know, so that's not what you see. And a lot of times what you see is what you be. So if that's not part of your experience, you don't know what to do with that. And so, you know, I followed the journey and I went corporate and all that kind of stuff. But I was not really happy with that. You know, it gave me anxiety and all that kind of stuff. And I started to realize that I had a bigger purpose in my life. And so once I got laid off and I said, well, I'm going to use this chance to, you know, blaze my own, move forward and blaze my own trail, you know, you got to really trust yourself in that journey, because, you know, everybody's not going to be in agreement with that, you know, because they want you to do.
You got a lot of guilt attached
to that. Yeah, they want you to do what they feel is the simplest, which is to go and get that job and work that job and know that, you know, you're going to get a paycheck every 2 weeks, regardless if you're happy or not.
Because happy wasn't part of the equation.
It's not part of the equation. Was
making it was enough. But, yeah, no, it's a different way. I mean, you know, and the internet changed everything.
Yeah.
You know, we were in school pre-internet.
Right.
But if we had all this then,
right,
you know, that would have been it, so.
Yeah.
Yeah, just trust yourself, you know. What would you say to yourself 5 years ago?
Don't be afraid. Don't be afraid. Because I think fear is one of the things that kept me stagnant from doing many of the things that I should have been doing. And I think another thing is you don't have to be what no one wants you to be. You can be you. And that's blazing the trail, like you said. So don't be afraid and go ahead and blaze your trail.
Right. I just think a lot of times, a lot of us, you know, we try to please everybody else, but in trying to please everybody else, we don't please ourselves.
Right.
Because we want to make everybody else happy. Right. But in turn, we lose our happiness because we're doing everything for everybody else. And so, you know, it took, I remember I went home one time and my best friend, and he was like, you have to be, and this is when I start using this word all the time. He said, you have to be 100% unapologetic about what you're doing. And understand that when you do that, everybody's not going to be happy with it.
Right.
You know what, Kevin? I remember I was at my sister's house one night, and I was going to wear this outfit. And I got to tell you, I wanted to wear these yellow socks because these yellow socks just matched to me. I loved it. And my sister and my other friends that was there, they was like, no, girl, that don't go. You can't wear them yellow socks with that. But I wanted to wear them yellow socks. But the long and short, I didn't wear the yellow socks. It makes me crack up even to today. I didn't wear the yellow socks, but years later, I was wishing I had worn them yellow socks. I would have stood out. People would have been like, boy, you look kind of country. But I would have pleased myself, and who knows? It might have been a fad that caught on. It could have made me millions of dollars. So, again, don't be fearful and blaze your trail and wear those yellow socks if you want to.
Socks on.
So, what would you tell the men out there, what would you advise you give to the men out there that's trying to do what you do, or just trying to be a better example to the community? What would you want to tell them?
First off, be true to yourself. And that's one of them things that sounds simple, but it's not easy.
It's not.
Especially when you've been living someone else's truth and someone else's truth about you for so long. You know, I feel better than I felt in years, man. You know, and a lot of that came from, you know, meditation. I always kind of stood one foot on one side, one foot on the other, just jumping over to my side totally, which meant that some people who I love very dearly, my beliefs from their beliefs changed. You know what I'm saying? But I had to be okay with that.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? And really walking my path. And I think that when anyone, any human being does that, you're going to get a piece that's going to make you a model. You're going to shine to others anyway, and they're going to see it. You know what I mean? Like, I'm not trying to put myself on anything, but I don't try to, like, hey, look at me. I'm doing so-and-so and such-and-such. People see it. Like, when it's someone I admire, I see what they're doing, they don't have to tell me anything. I can see that light.
Right.
I want to know more about them anyway.
Right.
And it really doesn't, you know, it don't matter what their title is.
Right.
It don't matter, you know, what they're doing. I'm coaching right now, but next year I might be doing, next month I might be, I can say next month, but next year may be something else. But whatever it is, it's something that I feel now I'm going to be true to me. Just so trying to get to that peace that's within you.
What I would say to you is, and watching you is, I respect your journey. I don't think you probably ever saw yourself becoming a coach. You know, but I think what happened is, I can say what I think happened, what I feel to be true happened to you is, that you surrendered to the universe and what you supposed to do. And that's what was teaching. You surrendered to that. That's what you supposed to do. That was your purpose, to help be the inspiration to the masses. With that, he took that of who you are and said, I need you to now use your gifts and talents to touch the kids as a coach. And that's just the next part of your journey. You might still keep on coaching, but there's gonna be the next step. It's gonna be a higher step for you, because you being, for me, how I see you at this present moment, you becoming very obedient to what universe wants from you. And I'll take myself for example. You know, I never saw none of this. You know, I told you I saw one of my friends from school one time. We had breakfast, and you know, I never did none of this stuff in college. You know, that was more him. And here I am doing this radio show. Here I am being this author, and this is none of the stuff that I ever saw for myself. You know, and but you know, I had to be obedient. And as I became more obedient, the opportunities came more and more. And you know, it's like, okay, the more you be obedient, the more he gives to you.
Absolutely.
You know, and so just like this young lady here, you know, I didn't see her in my path. You know, we met, we did my show a couple of times while at the old place, and we stayed connected, and then she disappeared because she moved. And when when it was at the right time, we reconnected. And when we reconnected, I was like, yo, so, we have listeners in Japan, we have listeners in, you know, Ghana and Johannesburg, Africa. So they reaching out to me and saying, are you still planning on coming to Africa? And I asked her, next thing you know, we going to Africa like in December.
Wow.
And you know, so that's just saying that's that, thank you. That's just saying that, you know, as long as you know, the journey, you can't control the journey.
Mm-hmm.
And whatever he has for you is going to be for you, you know. So I'm enjoying watching your journey from afar. And so just to see you become more elevated to what you're doing. So, you know, because you've been very, yeah, man, you've been very, you know, yeah. So, but,
Kev.
Ma'am.
You got somebody that just chimed in from South Carolina. Her name is Daisy. She said that that's so true what you're saying. Live your own truth and love yourself and make, this will make you have the right mindset going forward in life, and everything will manifest the way it should.
Absolutely.
So thank you, Daisy.
Absolutely. Thank you, Daisy. And that's true. And that, I think that's the hardest part is loving yourself. You know, a lot of people just don't love themselves, you know, and so they seeking love and validation from other people.
Right.
And what I had to learn and understand is I have to love myself enough and love and trust my journey, not to seek validation from anybody else. What's for me is for me. What I'm doing, I do it because I want to do it. This is what I want my journey to be.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm not asking for your approval.
Right.
You know, I think a lot of times we're asking, you know, because our self-esteem is low or we don't, our lack of love for ourselves is low, we seek validation from other people. And so instead of just doing it because we have the love to do it, it's something that we really want to do.
Mm-hmm.
So how did you get to that point? I'm going to ask you that too. How did you get to that point to where you stopped wanting to please everybody else and you just wanted to please yourself? Because that might be something that I think everybody struggle with, and so maybe what you did could help somebody else.
I wouldn't call it any one point.
Mm-hmm.
A series of events, and you look around and you say, okay, well, I mean, you kind of take stock. Let me back it up a little bit. I had a real good friend that I went to school with. And one of the things you say all the time, you don't want to hear God laugh, tell him your plans.
Right.
You know, because you can't plan this.
Right.
You don't go the way it's supposed to go. But for me, I'm more stubborn.
Mm-hmm.
You know, this is what I want to do, and this is how I want to do it.
Right.
And the thing about it is I was able to successfully do a lot of things, but they didn't bring about the result I thought it should bring.
Mm-hmm.
So I let not getting the material reward that I wanted for something discouraged me into thinking that it was not successful. It was not this and that, and I wasn't doing what I was supposed to do. So let me jump back to this beaten path instead of sticking with what it is I love, you know. And that tug of war just continued for a while, you know. And I think maybe a couple years ago, went through a divorce, all that kind of stuff, just kind of rebuilding and kind of looking at what I wanted to do. I was like, you know what? I'm done. I'm just off, you know, put this up. Put this into the universe. At that point, I was like, let's get this to the Lord. You know, this, at this point, it's become for me more or less the universe. And let that be done. Let that work through me. Whatever it is, I'm open. Because clearly, whatever it is I'm trying to plan for myself is not what's best. So let's go with what's best.
Right.
And as you've been saying, things have just been opening up.
Right.
Things where, you know, you banging to get in the door.
Mm-hmm.
Doors are just open.
You know what I mean?
You know, you fighting to get one way. Once you kind of surrender, I liken it to, you know, trying to always swim upstream, going with that flow. Going with that flow for you.
Right.
Not that flow that somebody else is supposed to.
So. And it's when people got to understand, it's still hard.
Mm-hmm.
You know, cause you still want to do what you want to do. And, you know, if it's for you, the door will open.
Yep.
If it doesn't open, it wasn't for you. And so, like, for me, I have to fully understand that, you know, me teaching spin classes, that was part of the journey, but that journey has now ended.
Mm-hmm.
Even though I love it and I be wanting to try to come back, every time I try to do something with that, the door closes because he's trying to tell me that's not what I want for you.
Mm-hmm.
This here, this show, you know, the books, the coaching, you know, us going to Africa, that's what he wants me. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
You know, the fact that I just got finished doing an interview for a magazine today, that's what he wants for me.
Mm-hmm.
And I have to understand that, you know. And so I think a lot of times we still, even though we know it, we still sometimes we want what we want.
Right.
And but when the door don't open, you have to understand, embrace the fact that that chapter has closed. Mm-hmm. How did you get to the point where you stopped seeking validation from other people?
Probably after I stopped giving my mortgage money to people, loaning it to them so they could get themselves out of the rut and I couldn't pay my own mortgage. I started to, of course, you know, you always call your mom and dad, and my mom was like, you did what? You got to stop doing that because blah, blah, blah. And she really supported me through any and everything that I did. And my sister, she was amazing, really supported me. And my brother, and friends, they supported me, but what they imparted into me was, look, it's okay to say no. Mm-hmm. And I just had this conversation on Saturday with my cousin Sharon, and she said at 40, for her biggest thing was to be able to say no. And I could identify with that, because when I was able to say no to what everybody else was trying to pull me to, oh, you're so great at this, can you come and can you help me and can you do that? I stayed off kilter with what God was calling me into. And then when I said to myself, I'm not going to be afraid anymore, because fear was a big factor. I'm not going to be afraid anymore. I have what it takes. And I got a friend, Donna Carlock, I remember she said to me, she said, girl, if I had the natural talent that you have, and she's very talented, she's very great at what she does. So for her to say this to me meant a lot, but she said, if I had the natural talent that you have of being able to reach people and talk to people and you change people's life for the better, she said, I would just go forward. And that helped me to move forward as well. So just like Lee said, it's a conglomerate of things that really helped to make me who I am today and continue to move forward. But when I just finally said, you know what, God, whatever it is, because I've been running for a while trying to escape what you've been trying to get me to do, but there's no way out, guys, and you know that as well as I. The only way out is in the graveyard, and Les Brown talked about that. There's so many unwritten books. There's so many unsung songs in the graveyard. It's the richest place on planet Earth.
That's right.
But when I decided to let my work and my wealth be done on earth, then my life changed around because I surrendered. All and right. when I surrendered, then everything started coming. I already wanted it. I already knew I could do it, but I was afraid. But when I got out of fear and I stepped into faith, things changed miraculous for me. And just things just started coming like never before. But I also had to learn to say no and stay focused. Like a few minutes ago, somebody texted me, hey, can you be on this webinar Thursday night? Unfortunately, no. I do a Think and Grow Richer every Thursday night at 8:00. I'm on that and I can't deviate from that because God has led me to that. So that's what happened for me. I just had to say no, step out of fear and move into faith.
Mm-hmm.
Let me ask.
Go ahead.
That really resonated. Two things I had to think about too that really did this too. Meeting people who are quote unquote successful, have everything that people deem successful, and seeing them to be miserable. I met a lot of people who were supposed to be on top, but they were just so so miserable. And just something I kind of lost the ability to do. Because, you know, you get older, you start worrying about so much stuff. I just remember when we were in school. Mm-hmm. Even before I came to Eastern, I was in school in Rochester, New York. I had a great time. We lived in the present. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? For me, yes. I had to get back to, like, and it took a lot to live in the present. Mm-hmm. I'm always trying to live in the future. I always think about, what is this going to do? What if I do this? What would this do? Mm-hmm. And you get so caught up in that, you miss your life.
Yes.
Because you're so worried about
right.
the outcome. You know what I mean? That you can't control.
Right.
You got to just take every minute, take it day by day.
Yep.
And you know, that sound, you know, I used to hear that, but it didn't mean anything. They're like, whatever, okay, this is what I'm gonna do. You know what
and
I mean?
See, a lot of people don't know how to be present in the moment. You don't get, like it's you were saying, you know, because we always focus on the future. You know, some of us still looking in the back, in the past, And so we never know how to be present. And, you know,
and
you
some
know.
Are even just, they're just afraid to be with their thoughts. They're afraid to turn everything off and just be. Have that silence and just be.
Right.
They got to keep something on. Got to keep just being distracted.
Because they, you know, when I say, like, you know, when I tell people, and we both told the audience what's our morning ritual. Mm-hmm. And so, like, for me, you know, when I wake up, I hydrate, but then I meditate. When I say that, is, well, that's the first thing they say is, how can you do that? Because, you know, I have all these thoughts, all these negative thoughts. I say, you got to learn how to silence those thoughts. I said, because meditation is you allowing God, the creator, whoever you believe in, to speak to you. And then after I do that, then I'll pray. And then I'll pray and let them know what I need from him. And then from there, I don't talk. I don't, even though I'm a business guy and I got stuff going on, I don't touch my phone for the first maybe hour and a half. You know, I send a YouTube video out to some of my friends, and I listen to that same video in the morning to start my day. Cause I want to be able to set the tone of how I want to be, and I don't want to allow the TV, social media, or anything to have control of how I set my day off. And I think a lot of times, like we always said, a lot of people are fearful of, you know, being with their thoughts because they have so much negative thoughts anyway. And so that's why I really try to pour a lot of positivity in that. So then therefore, my you know, it manifests positivity. You know what I'm saying? So this has been an amazing show. We're getting ready to get, you know, come down to the very end. I'm going to let you go last. Lotus, what is your parting thought? Whatever on your spirit, go for it.
As always, thank you for having me here, joining in your journey, and just joining in your life in general. It's amazing. So what I want to share with everyone tonight is Our Deepest Fear by Marianne Williamson. And some of you may have heard of it. It comes from this book, A Course in Miracles, okay? It says, our deepest fear is not that we are inadequate. Our deepest fear is that we are powerful beyond measure. It is our light, not our darkness, that most frightens us. We ask ourselves, who am I to be brilliant, gorgeous, talented, and fabulous? Actually, who are you not to be so? You are a child of God. Your playing small does not serve the world. There is nothing enlightened about shrinking so that other people won't feel insecure around you. We all are meant to shine. As children, we do. We were born to make manifest the glory of God that is within us. It is not just in some of us, it's in everyone. And as we let our own light shine, we unconsciously give other people permission to do the same. As we are liberated from our own fear, our presence automatically liberates others. So liberate yourself. Liberate other people. And remember, why not you? Why can't you be brilliant? Why can't you be perfect? Break out of fear and step into your faith.
Thank you, ma'am. That was, well, before I let him go, you know, I'm a big fan of hers. I read a few of her books, and she, when I lived in Detroit, for a few years, she was my minister.
Wow.
Yeah, she used to be a minister at one of the Unity churches in Detroit.
Yeah.
So one, it was like off of like 11 Mile Hoover. It was a Unity church there, and she was our minister, and I went there, and those was like my best years in Detroit. You know, because I was like really focused, you know, and once I lost that focus in that, you know, spiritual sense, everything went downhill for a second. So I had to like learn how to regain that, but. Brother, thank you for being on the show.
Thank you for having me.
Tell people how they can follow you and all that kind of good stuff, and then give us your parting thought. Whatever you want to talk about, it's up to you.
Okay. You can check out a new Facebook page, Instagram page for our team. It's called Tribe ATL. So that whole concept of tribe is something that, you know, at some point we want to take it from city to city at some point. Mm-hmm. A Tribe Cleveland, Tribe right. Chicago. We at D.C.? Virginia, yes. Virginia, Tribe D.C., you know. But it's a basketball program, but it's really devoted to youth development, academically, athletically, and probably most important, spiritually. So that's Tribe underscore ATL on Instagram, Tribe ATL Facebook page. Mm-hmm. Just getting going, so bear with us. Other than that, I mean, thank you so much for having me. Very grateful, very mm-hmm. appreciative. I've really been enjoying your journey. You know, thank you. More public, you know, in the man that you're becoming. I appreciate your efforts to unite us, you know, even outside of here, mm-hmm. with different alums and the work you do in the community and just the joy I've seen you do even in your span class.
So right.
People, you know, I've heard people talking about the class, especially when it was over, you know, in Lithonia. They don't even know I know you. You know what I'm saying? Like my name, right. Oh, that's my boy that does that. You
yeah.
know? So just seeing that, I love. Lotus, really enjoyed this. Really, it's funny, our connection with Marion Williamson. I was present in my law school class. So I addressed everyone at the end. Maybe the week before, I was looking for something, and I found that Our Deepest Fear online.
Mm.
Pulled it, you know what I'm saying?
Right.
Because it resonated even then. You know?
Right.
It was 99, but it resonated even then, you know? So just very, very powerful words, a very powerful person. And, I thank you both so much, you know.
This won't be the last time, brother. I want you to understand okay. that.
That's fine, too.
but what I will say, first of all, Lotus, thank you. I think a lot of times we're, you know, as men mm-hmm. of vision, a lot of times we need that woman behind you that also sees your vision, that sometimes could see things for you that you might not see for yourself because you're such a visionary. So this is one person who see a lot of things for me that I don't see for myself. Okay. And so I do respect that, and I respect her. I appreciate her for all that she does for me and will she see things bigger than me. So I do appreciate that. If I never said to you publicly, I'm saying it to you today. For you, you know, I'm just... I had to understand for you, it had to happen divine time for you.
Mm-hmm.
I've been wanting you on the show since I started doing the show.
Oh, wow.
But, you know, it had to wait for the right time for this to be happening. And so you did not disappoint whatsoever.
I appreciate it.
It's some things that I would love to do with you,
mm-hmm.
but I had to wait to the right time. And I think now is the right time. So maybe now, since I'm in your area a lot, maybe we could meet up and have a sure. and try to figure out what we could do, because we both men of community, and mentally and spiritually we think the same kind of way. So I think we could do more as a collective as well, but also as individuals. So that's one of the things I want to put on you as well. But at the end of the day, I just want everybody to be their best self, you know. And the first point to be the best self is to love yourself. And know that I have been taking your statement since you said it on the show a couple shows ago, that, you know, we try to figure out why, you know, we feel like we're not worthy. But you said a couple shows ago, when we were born, that was your birthright. You are now worthy of all things to you, because that's your birthright.
That's right.
And I have never forgot that. I tell it to my friends, that is your birthright. Stop not feeling that you're not worthy of anything of greatness. Because you were born, once you were born, you are a child of God, and that's your birthright mm-hmm. to be great.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, what I always ask people to do is stop asking for permission to be great and just be great. You know, and know that, you know, the universe, God, Allah, whatever you're waiting, he's mm-hmm. waiting for us to be great and step into the light, so he give you everything he wants to give you.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, there is no lack, there's abundance of everything. So that's why I always say I'm never in competition with nobody, because what's for me is for me, what's for Lois is for Lois, and what's for you is for you.
That's right.
And so that's why I want to bring all of us together, because we can't block for each other. You know, we're still gonna all manifest what we need to manifest. Absolutely. And so, you know, I want to help break the cycle of a crab and barrel mentality and know that there's no limits.
That's right.
There's no lack. It's abundance of all things. There's abundance of men for you ladies who think it's down, it's a shortage. Mm-hmm. It's abundance of women for us guys. It's abundance of money. You know, mm-hmm. we just have to change our mindset.
I agree.
You know, even though we don't like our current president, you know, what bothered me was how we felt like this is going to be a hard time for us.
Mm-hmm.
It's going to be a hard time for you if you believe that to be true.
Right.
That's what you manifest.
Right.
You know, look at the stuff that you haven't manifested in these 4 years. If you had that mindset, you would never have manifested it. The stuff that we're doing as individuals, we manifested that in these 4 years. But I said that, you know, we have to really practice what we believe to be true in our spiritual walk. You know, if you believe that God is the highest power and he orders our steps and he makes some mistakes, we can't be concerned about what that man's doing.
That's right.
Because at the end of the day, if we're concerned about what he's doing and he's trying to oppress us and all this kind of stuff, he's oppressing us because we allow him to.
Giving him power he don't
have. Giving him the power to that he don't really have because our higher power has the power.
That's right.
And so we have to understand that and let that be true.
Mm-hmm.
So with that being said, I want everybody to take their power back and be accountable for themselves and know that you are worthy of all greatness. So with that being said, I want to thank you, Lotus. Go ahead, go for it.
Katrina, I love you. Had to get that out there. Like, go home. All right.
But Lotus, I thank you. I'll see you next week.
Yes,
brother,
you.
I appreciate you.
Without a doubt,
man. And with that being said, this is the Oneness Architect Show. Be great, be authentic, and we are out. Peace.
Peace.